Happy morning. Today's topic is about infant deaths, part 1. In this video lecture, we will be discussing about some of the definitions and some terminologies in detail, like stillbirth and dead born, and the features to differentiate stillbirth from dead born, followed by the salient features of a dead born child. And finally, at the later section of the video, we will be discussing about the postmortem examination of an infant in detail. Kindly pay your attention, and if there been any doubts related to this video presentation, kindly address those issues in comment section below or any of the social media links provided in description section. First and foremost, the definition for infanticide, and the definition is, it's a unlawful destruction of a child under age of 1 year, and most commonly done by a maternal. And the possible causes or possible etiology are the sex of the child being the issue, and followed by other suffering from any chronic disease condition wherein the socioeconomic status of the family comes in, and an act of infanticide being committed. And in part of the definition, the infanticide does not include death of a fetus during the process of labor or any of the procedures like craniotomy or decapitation. And to other definitions, feticide. Here, it is a killing of a fetus at any time prior to birth. Fetus is within mother's womb by using radiological modalities. Identification of the fetus, especially the sex of the fetus, is being identified. If it is found to be against the wish of the intending couple, then an sex selective abortion is being performed wherein a fetus is being killed. And out of the proportion, male and female are more commonly undergo feticide, and even by the legal provisions, even it persists today. And coming to the second term, filicide, and the filicide can be divided into two types. One is of maternal and the second is of paternal. The other synonym for filicide is prolicide, and here it is a killing of a child by its parents. And coming to the types, maternal and paternal. Maternal filicide is more common, and here due to the aftermath of a delivery, wherein due to the disturbance of the consciousness level or the mind of a pregnant woman, as a result of the childbirth as well as the lactation, she undergoes a state called puerperal psychosis, wherein she commits an act of killing. And again, the maternal is being charged of a lesser offense of a manslaughter, and comparatively she gets a lesser term compared to a paternal filicide. And coming to the third terminology, neonaticide, is in a deliberate killing of a child within 24 hours of its birth. And in the term, neonaticide has been coined by Resnick in 1970. And a paradoxical term, and when you compare in obstetric point of view, where 28 days after birth is termed as a neonate period. And even though in forensic aspect of it, where neonaticide is considered to be killing of a child within 24 hours of its birth. And coming to the word stillbirth, and here stillbirth, the definition under that. Stillbirth, it means that a child is born after 28th week of pregnancy, which did not breathe or doesn't show any other signs of life at any time after being completely born. Child was alive in utero but dies during the process of birth. And stillbirth is frequently among illegitimate and immature children. And the possible etiology could be of anoxia, toxemia of pregnancy, prematurity, or the child being suffering from any of the congenital abnormalities. And those are the reasons wherein it can result in stillborn. And the question of stillbirth arises wherein charges of wrongful or a negligent act may be brought against the medical practitioner if an act that has resulted in a miscarriage or a stillbirth of a fetus. And here in case if it has been proved, then the medical practitioner is becoming liable to pay the damages if the harm is suffered as a result of his tortuous conduct. Deadborn fetus or otherwise dead birth child is one which has died in utero and shows any one of the following signs after completely born: in form of maceration or on features of rigor mortis or signs of putrefaction or the features of adiposity and mummification on the delivered fetus. And out of which is more common, and maceration is nothing but it is a process of aseptic autolysis, and this occurs when a dead child remains in utero for about 3 to 4 days surrounded with liquoramine with the exclusion of air. Exclusion of air, it means there is no any intake of air within the utero. And here it occurs due to softening effect of soaking on solid tissues. And the salient features of sign of maceration is being skin slippage, especially of the face, back region and the abdomen region, and which may be seen within 12 hours after the death of the fetus in utero, and where even a oblique pressure or on a minimal pressure that has been applied in where a loose epidermis layer exposes the red shiny the underlying dermal surfaces, especially more commonly noted on the prominent bony prominence. And by the 24th hour, skin appears brownish purplish in color, and the dead fetus has been soft, flaccid, with an emission of sweetish, disagreeable smell, and there is no any gas formation. And greater than 36 hours, there has been a cranial compression and a desquamation over 75% of the body surfaces are seen by 72 hours. And the cranial sutures overlap each other if there been a time elapse of greater than 96 hours. And if there been a greater than a week, then mouth appear widely open. Halting sign, a pathognomonic sign of intrauterine death. There has been a loss of an alignment and overlapping of fetal skull bones seen on X-ray, and the reason began it is occurring due to liquefaction of cerebrum and the softening of ligamental structures that are supporting the vault, and it classically appears around 7 days after death of the fetus in utero. And the second pathognomic sign of intrauterine death are Robert sign, appearance of gas shadows in the chambers of heart, great vessels, may appear around 12 hours after the death of the fetus, and the Robert sign is difficult to interrupt. Again, a X-ray finding. Other features of macerations are hyperflexation of spine is more commonly seen, crowding of ribs, shadows with the loss of normal parallelism, and features of mummification also occurs in, and it occurs due to results of a deficient blood supply and a scanty liquoramine and the fetus appears dried up and shriveled in greater than 2 weeks of TST. It able to differentiate a stillborn from a deadborn fetus. First criteria has been the definition, and coming to the second, the condition of the fetus, stillborn versus deadborn, and the condition of the fetus. Fetus was alive in utero but dies during the process of delivery. But in case of a deadborn fetus, it is already dead in within the utero. Regarding the predominance, illegitimate and immature male children are more prone for stillborn, and there is no such predominance in case of a deadborn fetus. And regarding the findings of stillborn fetus are signs of prolonged labor, and the presentation will be like edema over dependent parts, edema over scalp region, bleeding into scalp are the signs of prolonged labor that can be demonstrated on the fetus. Caput succedaneum and a severe molding of head may also be seen. And regarding deadborn, features of maceration, spalding sign are being seen. And leave of robot sign. And coming to etiology, in stillborn, anoxia, prematurity, birth trauma, and toxemia of pregnancy are the associated etiological conditions wherein it can result in stillborn fetus. And in case of deadborn, where any congenital anomalies of a fetus, ABO and RH incompatibility are the other causes for deadborn fetus. Postmortem examination of an infant. Before going to the complete discussion of this section of the video, wherein almost all proceedings almost similar to an adult deceased, and there are some exceptions, or otherwise there are some additional things we need to do in case of an infant, like estimation of age and estimating the gestational age of a fetus or an infant need to be done. And we need to establish whether it has been a stillborn, deadborn, or on a liveborn, and by various methods by which it can be done so. And third, most common circumstance where a fetus that has been discarded in a public dustbin or on a garbage, wherein a police officer receives a call, and he goes to the scene of crime or on a where there is a body that has been found, and he collects and he wraps in any of the material nearby, or he uses a cloth to carry for an autopsy room, and wherein there will be multiple artifacts present, and if there been intervention by lower animals, then most of the soft tissue may be missing, and that can result in multiple artifacts, and these things need to be kept in mind before commencing an autopsy towards the infant. Case of an infanticide, and here it includes examination of the mother as well as the fetus, and purely some special circumstances wherein an alleged mother is being brought for examination. Again, the case history will be of there being an a disclosure by the parents, and they have buried the fetus in nearby area, and a neighbor who had gotten a tip, and followed by he has informed the police, and the police has done a detailed investigation, and followed by the fetus that has been buried, and followed by the mother, alleged mother, is being brought for examination. And if this been a scenario, and here we need to look for signs of delivery, and based on the time period or based on the gestational age, the signs of delivery and signs of pregnancy may be seen on the alleged mother. And in part of an examination, her psychiatric conditions need to be assessed. And according to the previous part of a video, in the earlier section of the video, where there been a use of a word puerperal psychosis, so that is the necessary where an alleged mother need to be subjected for psychiatric assessment or psychiatric evaluation. And if it found to be false, then the mother been left out and the fetus, and it is up to the investigating officer need to look for the mother or the suspected parents, and we need to collect samples for grouping and DNA profiling from the fetus. Infant, first and foremost question that arises, whether the child was a stillborn or on a deadborn. Second, whether infant has attained the period of viable or not. Third, whether child was born alive. If so, what are the signs of live birth present? Fourth, what was the exact cause of death? We need to address these issues on completion of the autopsy. Coming to the word period of viability. Period of viability, it means the physical ability of a fetus to lead a separate existence after birth apart from its mother by the virtue of certain degree of development. And the child is considered to be viable after 210 days of intrauterine life. And there are some circumstances wherein child is being viable after 180 days of intrauterine life. The other something special, right? From the adult, we need to do an extra measurement or an extra work is we need to estimate the gestational age of the fetus, and by applying rule of Hayes, it is again a rough method of calculating the age of the fetus, wherein the RMP need to measure the ground to heel length of the fetus in centimeters. If it belongs to less than fifth month of pregnancy, then the square root of the length is being applied. If it belongs to the last 5 months of pregnancy, then the length of the child is being divided by 5, and by which an appropriate age of fetus is being estimated. Again, it is in a rough method of estimation. This is how length of the fetus is being measured. All right, and here see to that the lower limb is being extended, and crown to heel measurement is being taken. And there are some pre-requests before commencing an autopsy, like whole body radiographs to be taken in all possible views, like anterior, posterior, and the lateral views have been taken. Second, photographs of the external features of the fetus, frontal pictures of entire body, close-ups of face, sides of head, as well as the unusual aspects have been taken. And herein again, and if there have been any injuries that have been presented on the parts of a fetus, those again we need to give on an extra focus, and those again need to be snapped. Third, the procedure of autopsy is almost nearly the same as an adult, except certain variations like measuring the gestational age, estimating the gestational age, and doing an age estimation by looking for ossification centers. That's how it varies from an adult autopsy. Fourth, if there have been any presence of malformation, it is often the major consideration. Malformation in form of, if there have been a life-threatening malformations wherein the physical existence of a fetus is not been possible. So if those have been present, again it should be documented either by taking in a photograph as well as be documenting those in a autopsy report. In part of an external examination wherein clothes and the clothes, the other clothes that have been used for covering should be examined and retained for identification of a mother. And as in part of an external examination, wherein the head circumference, the chest circumference, and the abdominal circumference of the fetus is being measured and it should be documented. And weight of the body or weight of the fetus, again, it also helps us to assess the gestational age of the fetus. And in general features, if there have been presence of any dysmorphic features, it should be documented. And if it signifies any of the syndromes or any of the clinical conditions, then the karyotyping should be carried out. And if there have been any significant abnormal features that have been noted, even in internal examinations, in form of any form of dectocardia or other absence of any soft tissue or absence of any solid viscera, then it may arise due to any of the clinical syndromes, then a karyotyping is being necessary. And in case of head distribution and the quality of hair over the head and the rest of the body is being noted. And abnormalities of the shape of a head related to the molding or any trauma, or is there could be any soft tissue edema, hemorrhages, or any features of autolysis, if it been present, those are also being noted. And coming to face, facial features are being examined and any abnormalities to be recorded. Configuration of the ear is being examined, and plasticity indicating the amount of cartilage and evaluated as an index of developmental stage. If in by a late intrauterine development, where crest of external ear should be superior to the level of later canthus. In extremities, the position of hand, feet, as well as the fingers and nails to be noted. Perineal area is being inspected and checked for patency of anal opening. And in case of a male child, the position of the meatus as well as the scrotal sac and its contents are being palpated. And in case of a female, the position of the meatus and the configuration and the relative size of labia, clitoris are being observed. Vernix tissue, the presence of vernix tissue is not an useful thing, even though if it absent, it indicates the child has been washed and suggesting that it has survived for some time after birth. And herein again, a waxy-like substance seen over the body and usually present after five months of intrauterine life. And if it absence, it indicates it has survived for some period of time. Changes of putrefaction. And again, it helps us to ascertain the time since death and the bodies of newborn infants are normally sterile. And when they birth or when they swallow, then the microorganisms enters in body. And therefore, in stillborn, the putrefaction occurs from outside to inwards. And as in case of a live-born child, from within to outwards, it occurs in. And decomposition must be differentiated from features of maceration, as in maceration is in a sure sign of dead bone fetus. And if a fetus is being decomposed, it will be almost certainly be impossible to determine whether it is when a live birth has occurred in. Of injury, all injuries and bruises, especially around nose, mouth, and the position and the status of the frenulum should be noted and it should be photographed. And any inflicted injury should be carefully distinguished from other injuries owing to both trauma and the normal anatomical features and postmortem damages to be kept in consideration. And here in case multiple scratch abrasions are seen, and again it is due to the presence of a thorn or any other external substance that has been present on the near to the scene of crime. And again, pinpoint bloody discharge at places, drying of lips have been noted. Placenta. The placenta may be seen along with the residue along with the fetus, or otherwise it may be attached along with the fetus with the help of an umbilical cord. And here the placenta should be weighed, and we need to evaluate the maturity as well as if there been any abnormality, it should be observed and it should be documented. And at the near to the term, the placental diameter will be of 15 to 20 centimeter, and the central thickness will be of 2.5 centimeter, and the placenta will weigh about 500 grams. Before proceeding to the examination point of view of towards placenta, various other placental conditions may also result in stillbirth. And most two conditions like abruptio placenta and placenta previa to be kept in mind. And first and foremost is abruptio placenta, where it may be associated with extensive retroplacental bleeding, and it may compromise the placental and fetal oxygenation. Second, placenta previa, where it can also result in extensive massive hemorrhage once the labor is initiated, wherein death of both mother and infant can occur in. And if unless there been an urgent medical intervention has been provided. Regarding umbilical cord, a cord length of 54 to 61 centimeters, or with the short cords measuring less than 30 centimeters, or on a long cord measuring greater than 100 centimeters. And especially long cords may cause blood flow obstructions, and if there been a prolapse, torsion or knotting can occur in. And in cases where the long cords can even wrap around the neck of the fetus, and it can also result in asphyxia. And in case of on a short cords where a blood flow may also be compromised as a result of excessive traction during the delivery. And in part of internal examination, for detailed internal examination, most commonly adopted is modified Y-shaped incision, where the incision extends from both of the mastoids up to top of the sternum. Then it is being used to extend downward in a midline up to pubis. And in case of a head dissection, a part of a cranium is being removed with the help of an incision that has been extending from ear to ear. And in some special circumstances where fetus incisions that are also being made on the back aspect of the infant to exclude any form of tortures. And again, by sorting this sort of an incision, wherein any deep seated conditions can be demonstrated. And not routinely done. And if there have been any features of a torture, or in any forms of any physical abuse on a part of any part of a body, then it is mandatory to do a dissection on even on the posterior aspect to detect any deep-seated conditions. The other method by which the skull structures can be opened in case of a fetus and infant is by applying Benig's technique. And here, after reflecting the layers of scalp, where cranium and dura on the both sides can be cut through ana with the help of a blood scissors, starting at the lateral edge of the anterior fontanelle and extending the incision along the midline as well as on the later sides of the skull, and even the incision extends from the up to anterior segment. And the midline strip is about 1 centimeter wide, and it also includes superior sagittal sinus and the flax. And once the incision been carried, when the structures have been cut, then it can be opened like opened and reflected as in a butterfly manner. And in case of a brain, while reflecting the layers of scalp, if there been any abnormality, note whether there been any subaponeurotic hemorrhages to exclude any forms of asphyxia or otherwise deep bruises. Examine, and here any unnatural causes like strangulation can result in injuries over the soft structures of neck. And even trachea need to be examined for any presence of foreign body, froth, mucus, or amniotic fluid. And amniotic fluid? If there be an aspiration of amniotic fluid within the utero, then it can be detected in. And in case of a thorax, and here the opening of thorax is been delayed, and once a special precautions that has been followed in infant autopsy, where abdominal organ or abdominal cavity need to be opened first, and after opening abdominal cavity, the position of the diaphragm is being noted by passing on a finger, then the dissection is being carried out, then the thorax cavity or the chest region can be opened. Whole chest cavity can be opened under water to demonstrate pneumothorax, and in another method of dissection or retrieval of body organs like Littles technique can also be executed, and wherein the en masse removal is being preferred in most of the cases, wherein for detecting any rare malformations and the particular architecture of the corresponding organs is being properly preserved. Any abnormality in form of any free blood, fluid, pus, or contents of stomach within thoracic or abdominal cavity, and if there been presence of a rupture of a diaphragm, then this presentation is more likely. And also check for any fractures of rib to be noted. If there been any evidence of malformations, birth injuries, that should be meticulously searched in, and which may also relieve obvious incompatibility with the continuation of life. Demonstration of centers of ossification, and here we don't routinely do in adult, and special indication wherein in infant autopsy it be carried out. And from the previous slides, where rule of phase is a rough method of estimation of gestational age, and if the ossification centers have been demonstrated, and we can pinpoint the accurate gestational age of the fetus. And here most commonly limbs sternum have been employed, and by detecting the ossification centers we can able to opine on the gestational age of the fetus. We look for ossification centers over parts of limb and sternum, and it should be meticulously searched for. And by looking these ossification centers, we can able to determine the age of the fetus. And here, by the simplest of example, where An autopsy surgeon looks for the ossification center over calcaneum, and it is been present, and it suggests it has been 5 months, and he need to look for in a higher order, right? The next ossification center. If the fourth division of the sternum doesn't show or doesn't bear an ossification center, then the age of the fetus is around 5 months. If it has been present, then he need to look for another higher order of ossification center. Next higher order will be seen on the talus bone. And if even this been present, then we need to proceed to the next higher order of ossification center. Especially at birth, a center of ossification usually present on part of a cuboid and as well as on the upper end of the tibia. And how could sternum, first and foremost, where a bone need to be placed on a wooden board and it being sectioned in its long axis within a cartilage knife, and which exposes the centers of ossification. And even in some techniques where the sternum being shown on a flash of light or on a light, where an ossification center can be seen. And here the most common, where on the body of manubrium sternum, the ossification centers appear by 5th month, and in first segment of the body of sternum, it is by 5th month, and the second segment 7th, third segment following it on the 7th month, 10th month on the 4th segment of the body of sternum. And if these been present, and all these ossification centers occurs before the birth of the fetus. At knee joint, where an incision need to be made at the knee joint, and we are about to estimate or about to look for the ossification centers on lower end of femur as well as on the upper end of tibia. And to make it convenient for an autopsy surgeon, wherein a leg of the fetus is being flexed against the thigh, and a horizontal incision is being made on the knee joint. Followingly, patella bone is being removed, and a number of cross sections have been made through the epiphyses, starting from the articular surface and continuing until the last cross section of the ossification center that has been arranged. If this been present, then the its corresponding gestational age is being identified. At the bones of foot, where heel of foot is being held by one hand, and followingly with an other hand, an incision is made through the interspace between 3rd and 4th toes and carried down up to the sole of a foot and the heel. And followingly, a corresponding ossification center is being seen on part of a cuboid or part of a calcaneum. And coming to preservation of samples, and most commonly, and here the blood and the tissue samples need to be taken for grouping and cross matching. And if an alleged mother has been identified, wherein a maternal blood groups can be compared, wherein, and even blood need to be collected for an DNA. And if blood is not been available, then we need to harvest a bone, an intact bone, and it should be dried and it should be packed for DNA profiling. And second, towards if there will be no any features of decomposition, then we need to collect viscera for microbiological workup. And if there been presence of placenta, again it should be subjected for microbiological as well as histopathological examinations. And most of the major organs, tissues, specialized testings for metabolic abnormalities, and we don't do routine metabolic abnormalities. If there have been features of dysmorphic features, or there have been any congenital abnormalities wherein we can able to link some syndromes or some congenital disease, then again a suspected a metabolic analysis can be carried out. And in case, right, and where the external or the perineal region show multiple injuries and there have been multiple contusions on the margins and other, then we need to take a swab from the every orifice, and it may be even a case of a sexual assault. And coming to cause of death, the cause of death can be divided into natural, unnatural, and unnatural can be further classified into accidental and criminal. And accidental again subdivided into perinatal, postnatal, and criminal can be divided into acts of commission and acts of omission. Concerning with the time period of this video, I just read the headings alone, and a detailed video regarding the cause of death will be posted shortly. And first and foremost, the natural causes: prematurity, congenital malformations, birth traumas, intrapartum asphyxia, neonatal infections, and blood group disorders, and conditions of placenta, toxemia of pregnancy, SIDS could be the natural causes that can be the reason for cause of death. And coming to unnatural causes, under heading accidental, it can be divided into perinatal, postnatal, and in case of perinatal, injuries to mother, prolonged labor, prolapsed cord, twisting of cord around the neck of the fetus, or even death of a mother could be the perinatal causes. Postnatal, towards suffocation and precipitate labor, could be the accidental cause under postnatal. And in unnatural causes, criminal causes, acts of commission, and where something is not to be done but it has been done intentionally, and in form of strangulation or poisoning of a fetus or an infant, smothering, causing head injury or causing cutthroat injury, concealed puncture wounds, twisting of neck, burning, drowning, all these comes under acts of commission. And criminal and acts of omission, and here the parent or the a doctor need to give an attention, or he need to provide something for the good of the child, but he fails to provide. And failure to provide proper assistance during labor, second, failure to clear the air passages, third, failure to protect the child from exposure to heat and cold, fourth, failure to supply child with a proper nutritious food. These all constitute acts of omission. Thank you so much for your patient listening. If there been any doubts, queries relating to the content of the video, kindly address those issues in comment section below. Thank you.